Let's get started with the accounting process now. If I have to tell you, the accounting process can be summed up into five simple steps in the following order. Step one, identify transactions. Step two, do a journal entry. Step three, prepare a ledger account. Step four, prepare a trial balance. And step five, you have to prepare the financial statements like profit and loss account, balance sheet, statement of cash flow. Okay. You may see trading account listed here. The reason I have not mentioned is because not all companies prepare trading account, but I have included it here because I want to explain it and we can go through it. Okay. Let's dig deeper to understand these concepts. The very first step in accounting starts with identifying a transaction with a proof. Okay. Let's say you sell something or buy something, right? You need some sort of a proof for that, like an invoice for the things that you bought, or a bill or a voucher for the items that you've sold. The proof is also called as a source document. And this becomes a starting point for our accounting process. The second step that follows after identifying transactions is recording these transactions. Where do you record these transactions? You record these transactions in a book called journal. And the act of recording the transactions in the journal is called journal entry. Now you may ask a question, what is journal and why it should be recorded only in journal? Well, journal means a diary in simple terms. In past days, people used to record everything in their diaries. In other words, they used to call this diary as a journal. From the practice, it arrived that we need to record every business financial transactions in a business diary called journal, hence the name journal. But unlike we write the way we want in our personal diaries, there is a standard that we need to follow to record the business financial transactions, and it is called journal entry standards. Now let's look at the rules that we need to follow to record these journal entries. There is something called double entry system. Okay, if you remember, we said every transaction has two events. So both events of a transaction need to be recorded in the journal. One event of the transaction would be a credit, and the other event of the transaction would be a debit. Okay, I repeat, one event of the transaction would be entered as a credit, and the other event of the transaction would be entered as a debit. Credit entry is done on the right side of the journal. The debit entry is done on the left side. Okay, so the amount for the credit and debit should always match. Let's say we sold a product for $200. From the company's standpoint, the product worth is $200. And we have received $200 from the other party. So the entry for the credit and the debit should have $200. Okay, they should match with each other. Now, which entry goes where? I will explain that, okay? But we need to remember to keep things in balance. The amount for credit and the amount for debit should always match. Transactions in themselves are various in nature. A transaction could be for buying something from a vendor. A transaction could be for selling something to a customer. A transaction could be taking a loan. So these are different types of transactions that happen in a business world. In the business world, categorization is based on the type of the transactions. And the event is called an account. Okay. So there are two events. Now, based on the event type, we have to categorize them under these three types that we have on the screen: personal, real, and nominal. These are called accounts, okay? Personal account, real account, and nominal account. So why are they being called accounts? Because depending upon the type of transaction event, they may go into either personal, or they may go into real, or they may go into nominal. Now we need to understand what transaction events come under personal, what transaction events come under real, and what transaction events come under nominal, okay? So let us discuss the different types of accounts. So let's start with personal account. Any transaction event related to a person or a company or an entity comes under personal account. Okay, if you take an example, let's say you've done a transaction with John. The transaction would have two events for you. Transaction events that are related to John would come under personal account. And similarly, companies would get into transactions with another company, right? So those transactions will also come under personal accounts. Any transaction that you do with a bank, they will also come under personal account because bank is an entity, okay? And for transaction events related to assets and liabilities, will fall under real accounts category. It could be your tangible assets or it could be your intangible assets, okay? It could be any liabilities. So any transaction event that is related to an asset or a liability would fall under real accounts. So now let's look at nominal accounts. Transaction events related to income, expenses, any investments that the firm made, profits, short-term gains, all are recorded under nominal accounts, okay? So now let me give an example and then let me show you how the transaction events fall into different accounts, okay? Now, let's say you bought a car for $10,000 cash. So here we have two events. You bought a car, you paid in cash. You bought a car, right? What is a car? Car is an asset, right? We've seen here transaction events related to assets come under real accounts, right? So the second event is you paid in cash. What is a cash? Cash is an asset, right? And the transaction event related to asset falls under real account again. So in this transaction, both the events belong to real account category. Okay. So it is not necessary that all the times that both the events should fall under one category type. Sometimes a transaction which has two events, one of the events can get into real account, one of the events can get into nominal account. It depends. So you now know that you can break the transaction into two events and one of the events, as per the rule, will get into one of the accounts, right? But you also need to understand which of this transaction event is a credit and which of this transaction event is a debit. There is a rule actually, okay? So this is a simple rule. If you remember this rule, it will help you understand which event is a credit, which event is a debit, okay? I'm going to explain these rules now. Okay, for the transactions related to a personal account, you need to debit the receiver and credit the giver. Okay, let's say John is giving $2,000 to our company ABC. Okay, John, who is he? Is he the giver or the receiver? So remember, we need to look at the transactions from our perspective. Let's say we are the company ABC. John is giving $2,000 to company ABC. Now, who is the giver? John is the giver. Who is the receiver? We are the receiver. So the transaction event, we will debit on company ABC and we will credit John because he is the giver. Okay. And for the transaction events related to real accounts, you need to debit what comes in and credit what goes out. Okay. I repeat, for the transaction events related to real account, you need to debit what comes in and credit what goes out. Let's take the car example again, okay? Let's say you bought a car for $10,000, okay? You bought a car, which is an asset. Now, this comes under real account, correct? And you gave the cash, which is an asset again, and this comes under real account. Now, as per the rule, what does it say for real accounts? Debit what comes in. What is coming in? The car is coming in, right? Car is an asset. So we would debit what is coming in. Car is coming in. So write in car account debited, okay, for 10,000. What is going out? Cash. Cash is again an asset. So we would write cash account credited $10,000, okay? This is how you need to write, okay? So debit entry is done usually on the left side. Credit entry is done usually on the right side. So it should look something like this. Car account debtor, $10,000. Cash account creditor, $10,000. Debtor is nothing but a debit entry. Creditor is nothing but a credit entry, okay? BR, they call it debtor. CR, they call it creditor. Okay, I will give you one more example. Bear with me. This is just to help you clear the concept, okay? Let's say you paid a daily wage of $240 cash. Now, this transaction has two events. Again, you paid the wage. What is a wage? Wage is a direct expense, right? And the direct expense comes under nominal accounts. And let's look at the second account. How much did you pay? You paid $240 cash, right? So what is a cash? Cash is an asset and comes under real account. Okay, cash is going out. So we can call this labor as a wage account, or we can just mention the labor. Okay, so you can write it as labor account debtor $240 and cash account CR $240, right? The double entry should look like this. Some people may even get a doubt. I told there are three types of accounts: personal, real, and nominal. But I'm writing here something like cash account or labor account and so on, instead of writing the nominal account and real account. I'll explain the difference. These three accounts I mentioned are the categories. Let's say you have written ABC Bank. Now, this is an account that falls under personal account. Because it is an entity, all the accounts related to entity will fall under personal account. Okay, hope you're now getting the gist of how the double entry system works. As I mentioned, the idea is to get you the concepts right. Okay, but what I observed is on different forums, people have a difficulty remembering these rules for these three account types, like personal account, real account, and the nominal account. So how do you remember this? So for that, I'm going to give you a tip how to remember these rules. Okay, I will just give you a mnemonic with which you can remember these rules. So remember these three statements and you will never forget the rules for these three accounts. Okay, first statement for personal account: personal doctor is a cool gentleman. In this statement, personal stands for personal account, D in DR stands for debit, R in DR stands for receiver. Okay, and the C in the word cool stands for credit, G in the word gentleman stands for giver. If you remember this word, personal doctor is a cool gentleman, then it is easier to remember that particular rule. So coming to the real accounts, remember this: real don comes in, criminal goes out. Real is the name for real account. D in the don is for debit. Comes in is what comes in. Okay, so debit comes in, and then we have criminal goes out. C stands for credit here. Okay, in the criminal, C stands for credit. Goes out is what goes out. So in real accounts, debit what comes in, credit what goes out. And we have third one, which is nominal account. So for that, normally dashing entrepreneurs like cars, iPhones, and gadgets. If you could remember, normally dashing entrepreneurs like cars, iPhone, and gadgets. So normally would stand for nominal account, D stands for debit, E stands for expenses, L stands for liabilities. Okay, debit, expenses, and liabilities. And then C in the cars stands for credit, and I in the iPhone stands for income, G in the gadget stands for gains. So for nominal accounts, debit, expenses, and losses, credit, incomes, and gains. Okay. And also, coming back to the point, this is important for you to remember. Okay, you might have some notion that credit is a bad and debit is good, or vice versa. So just to clear this air, in accounting world, the words debit and credit have no confirmed meaning. They do not have any negative or positive notions attached to them. It all depends on the transaction event type and the account category under which they fall. Okay, in some places credit is good, in some places debit is good. So we cannot really justify or have an opinion on them. Okay, just remember that. Okay, you just have to enter the debit and credit as per the rules. That's it. So later I'm going to make an in-depth video on each of these topics, and one of them would be recording general entries as well, in which I will dig a lot deeper again to make you guys master the subject. So please do look out for such videos. One thing to remember: if the quality of your general entries is good, then the output of your financial records will be good. Otherwise, things will mismatch. So doing an accurate general entry is key to avoid problems going ahead. Okay, so if you look at the screen, this is what the rules of the journal entry is. To record a transaction, every transaction must have a debit entry and a credit entry. The amount of debit should be equal to the amount of credit. Bifurcate the transaction type and see which transaction event will fall under which account type. And analyze which transaction event to be credited and which one to be debited based on the debit and credit entry rules we just discussed. Okay, so now let us look at the ledger account. Let's first understand what it means by a ledger.